Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Refreshed by the resurrection life we share in Christ, let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We thank you, risen Christ, for these waters where you make us new, leading us from death to life, from tears to joy. We bless you, risen Christ, that your Spirit comes to us in the grace-filled waters of rebirth, like rains to our thirsting earth, like streams that revive our souls, like cool cups of water shared with strangers. Breathe your peace on your church when we hide in fear. Clothe us with your mercy and forgiveness. Send us companions on our journey as we share your life. Make us one, risen Christ. Cleanse our hearts. Shower us with life. To you be given all praise with the Holy Spirit in the glory of God now and forever. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Welcome to worship. We gather this day in the season of Easter. Always good to be reminded that as a Christian community, Easter is a season of celebration for us. A 50-day celebration until we arrive at the day of Pentecost. And so you will continue to hear about the resurrection in our risen Lord and be invited into that celebration of Christ's victory over the grave. I'm mindful this week that that can be a daunting task. The truth is there's all kinds of anxious and fearful news, not only far away, but in the nearness of our own community, in our own lives, in the radio, in the car, in the newspapers, on the television, everywhere we go. Anxious and fearful news. I'd invite you in a time like this to bring particular focus on a Sunday morning as we attend to the words of Jesus, as we listen to the one who speaks to us, words of life and hope in the midst of anxiety and fear. We sing the Kyrie together.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. The peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. This holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Victory for our God, alleluia. Worthy is Christ, the Lamb who was slain, whose blood set us free to be people of God.
Let us pray. Holy and righteous God, you are the author of life, and you adopt us to be your children. Fill us with your words of life, that we may live as witnesses to the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. A reading from the third chapter of the book of 1 John. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he was revealed to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The Gospel according to Luke. Jesus himself stood among the disciples and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened, and why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy, they were disbelieving and still wondering. He said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Grace and peace to you from the risen Lord, who reaches out to you with wounded hands. The voices that we listen to matter. The voices we listen to become a part of us. The voices we listen to shape our thoughts. They harden or soften our hearts. It has been a week of voices. The anguished voice of Dante Wright's grandmother crying out on my car radio. I listened as this heartbroken woman screamed out, "He might not have been an angel, but he was our angel." The pain in her voice made me wince. I could feel her hot tears on my face. And like Dante's life, her voice matters. Throughout the week, we have also heard courtroom voices. I listen to the voices of lawyers and of witnesses for the prosecution and for the defense. Some of those voices were heavy with grief. Other voices were calculating and clinical. And with the world, we all wonder, what voices will the jury listen to? There are blessings even in the bleakest times. Flowers bloom. The sun rises and sets. Birds are still singing. I imagine that all of this was true for Jesus' followers in the days after his death. The world's beauty still remained, but their eyes were not opened to see it. Their senses were not open to receive that beauty. They could see only the image of Jesus' body nailed to the cross. They could hear only the cries of the heartbroken, the ones grieving the death of their angel. In difficult times, the voices that we listen to matter. Who we choose to let into our hearts and into our minds, that matters. This morning, I invite you to listen to the words of Jesus. Listen to the words of our crucified and risen Lord. To all who are shaken by doubt and fear. To all who are made numb by the violence and fear of this world, Jesus says, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at me. Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I. Touch me and see. It is I. Open your hearts and offer me something to eat." In a week of voices, this is the voice that I want you to hear, Jesus' voice. And I want you to know that Jesus' voice is a living voice. This offer to touch his wounded hands, to receive him as a guest. Those words are the same words that you hear in the voice of Dante Wright's grandmother pleading for you to share with her, to feel her grief and her pain. Touch me. See me. Listen to me. Receive me as your guest. I believe that God abides with us and speaks to us at all times, in good times and bad, in times of joy and in times of sorrow. Weariness and selfishness and trauma, these things can make it hard for us to hear God, to see God, but God remains. God's steady voice remains. We can practice our faith by simply trying to listen for God's voice in the world around us. We can listen to trial witnesses. We can listen to grieving grandmothers. We can listen with the belief that Christ is still speaking to us. He's coming to us with wounded hands. When we touch the wounds of our neighbors, when we see them, when we listen to them, and when we offer them something to eat, Jesus promises to appear before us. The peace of Christ comes to us through our openness, through our listening, through our hospitality. Jesus spoke to me through the radio this week. In a week of voices, Jesus' voice came to me through the voice of a woman named Salma Hassan Ali. Salma is a mother, and she is a Muslim. She's also the author of a new book that invites fellow Muslims into the practice of generosity during their holy season of Ramadan. It is a book written for her own children. And it's a book she wrote for a world in need of an uncommon kindness. When I say that I heard Jesus speak through her, I'm not being vague or general. I mean that her words, her specific words, were filled with the same wisdom and love of our Lord. I was thinking about Jesus' tenderness. Jesus' gentleness as he reached out to those he loved with wounded hands. I was thinking about the way he reminded his followers, prompted them to be good hosts, to find him something to eat, to not forget to receive him as a guest. And then Salma said these words, "Practice being generous. Spoil others with an uncommon hospitality." In a week of voices, in a week of suffering and anxiety and fear, this is what I heard Jesus say. Practice being generous. Spoil others with an uncommon hospitality. After the resurrection, Jesus' followers struggled with doubt and fear, and into this world of terror, into this world of disbelief, Jesus invites those he loves to practice generosity, to practice hospitality. In a world where justice is being decided in the courthouse, and where ongoing protests are taking place in the streets, hospitality, offering broiled fish to a hungry neighbor, that may not seem so important. But if we choose to ignore the voice of Jesus, we are simply wrong. In times of grief and anxiety, in times of weariness and fear, in times like these, uncommon generosity, uncommon hospitality, this is what our Lord commands. Spoil others with uncommon hospitality. When I was just a few years older than Dante writes, Natalie and I spent a year living and working in the West African nation of Cameroon. That was more than two decades ago, but I still have memories that can move me to tears. The simplest way for me to explain it is just to say that we were strangers. We were not exactly refugees. We were not immigrants. But we were strangers a long, long way from home. Sometimes being in a faraway place was exciting. Trips to the local market were an adventure. I have good memories. It was joyous to sit on our front porch and to simply watch children throw rocks to knock guava fruit down from a tree. But mostly being strangers far from home was overwhelming, and it was lonely. We felt invisible. We felt displaced. There was no regular phone or internet service. When we would go out, we would smile at our neighbors, but all the while we were simply trying to hide our pain. But like the disciples after the resurrection, our hearts, they were filled with doubt and fear. I think this is how many of our neighbors right here in Minneapolis are feeling. They feel invisible. They feel displaced. They try to soldier on and hide their doubt and fear, but inside they are feeling overwhelmed. They are feeling alone. They are hungering for an uncommon generosity, this uncommon hospitality that our Lord commands. About 40% of the population of Cameroon is Muslim. And when we were there, an American couple from Wisconsin, of all places, were Lutheran missionaries sent to help build relationship with that Muslim community. When I first saw him, I would not have guessed that Charlie Bunk was from Wisconsin. His skin was tanned dark brown from the African sun, and he wore a long shirt and hat in the local Muslim style. Charlie spoke French, and he spoke Fufulde, the common language of many Muslims in Cameroon. When I heard Salma Hassan Ali speak those words of Jesus to me on the radio this week, Charlie and his wife Barb came into my mind. I remembered them, and my heart filled up until there was moisture in my eyes. Charlie and Barb were strangers to me and Natalie. We shared American citizenship with them, and we were both in Cameroon because of the Lutheran Church. But that is where the similarities end. They were old enough to be our parents. We only saw them occasionally at missionary meetings in a town about 3 hours from where we lived. But Charlie and Barb listened to the voice of Jesus. They listen to the voice of our Lord who commands us to share uncommon generosity, to spoil others with uncommon hospitality. We did not ask them to, but Charlie and Barb arranged to spend a week in that little town where we lived. When others failed to notice our wounded hearts and hands, they saw us. They heard the cries of our hearts. They listened to our loneliness, this thing that we worked so hard to hide. Charlie arranged to teach some local classes in that town where we lived, but they really had come simply to care for us. That week, they would sit on our porch. They would talk with us in the evening. They would take walks with us. they would eat with us. They knew that our hearts were hungry, and they gave us good food to eat. One evening, Barb painted a picture in watercolor of that little house where we stayed. And we still have that watercolor painting. It's still hanging in our home to this day. Practice generosity. Spoil them with uncommon hospitality. When our neighbors feel invisible, when they feel displaced in the communities where they live, Christ commands us to see and to listen and to offer an uncommon hospitality. I do not know if there will be justice for George this week. I do not know if there will be more grandmothers weeping, crying out in pain for the ones they love. And not knowing can feel overwhelming, and it can feel discouraging. It can cause us to doubt and to lose hope. To all who long for peace, to all who wonder what can be done, Jesus speaks. Jesus speaks through Salma Hassan Ali and through Charlie and Barb Bunk. Jesus speaks through the grandmother of Dante Wright. Jesus speaks through the child in your neighborhood feeling unsafe in the skin that God gave them. Jesus speaks, and he tells us what to do. Practice generosity. Spoil them with uncommon hospitality. See your neighbor. Listen to your neighbor. Offer them good food to eat. Amen.
As once you walked through it.
Please join me in confessing our faith in the ancient words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Alive in the risen Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we bring our prayers before God, who promises to hear us and to answer in steadfast love. Living God, in the midst of Easter joy, we are still filled with questions and wondering. Open our hearts and minds as we encounter the Scriptures, so that the church embodies repentance and forgiveness in the name of Jesus to all nations. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Creating God, like a master artist, you have fashioned the universe out of your love and delight. Heal your creation where it is in need of restoration. Provide all the inhabitants of earth a peaceful and sustainable home. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God of all, we carry the message of Easter hope into a world overwhelmed by fear and violence. In our own community, the death of Dante Wright again exposes the brokenness of our society. While anxiety and anger spill into the streets, a grandmother's voice can be heard lamenting the death of another beloved child. Help us, O God, to listen to her voice. Help us to love our grieving neighbors. As the world prepares for the verdict in the trial of Derek Chauvin, we pray for your justice. We pray for your mercy. We pray for your new life in Minneapolis. We pray for an end to violence against black bodies and for the resurrection of a new world where each of your precious children is treated with honor and love. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Healing God, you hear the cries of those in need and you answer them in their distress. Grant to those who are sick and suffering your compassion and nurse them back to health and wholeness. Be close to the hearts of the lonely. We pause now to offer up the names of those who need your peace and healing, silently or aloud. Rich, for Lori, for Audrey. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Loving parents, you have given us such love that we should be called the children of God. Reveal yourself to us so that we in this community of faith will become more and more like you in our mutual love and our bold witness. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. We now take time to offer up any other prayers, silently or aloud, for what else do the people of God pray? Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. God of all times and ages, those who have died in you now see you as you are. We thank you for their lives among us. Assure us of the peace you have promised, that we may join them in everlasting life. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. In the hope of new life in Christ, we raise our prayers to you, trusting in your never-ending goodness and mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I invite you to be seated. And I also invite you to ongoing generosity, very much the theme of the preaching this day, that invitation by Jesus himself to generosity, to hospitality. Invite you to claim that as a spiritual discipline in your life. And also want to lift up our April cause of the month. Hopefully you are aware, we have plans to build a community garden in front of our building, a beautiful space that things can grow and be shared with our neighborhood, with the children in our child care center. So I invite you to give to that. Anything designated cause of the month will go towards our community garden this month of April. We turn to our musical offering. God of love, you call us beloved children and welcome us to your table. Receive our lives and the gifts we offer. Abide with us and send us in service to a suffering world for the sake of your beloved child, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Gathered in from scattered places, Christ unites us at God's table of love and mercy. Please gather the bread and juice or wine that you have prepared, and let us join together in the celebration of Holy Communion. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and we join their unending hymn.
Ever understand, you are always
God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, you have brought us this far along the way. In times of bitterness, you did not abandon us, but guided us into the path of love and light. In every age, you sent prophets to make known your loving will for all humanity. The cry of the poor has become your cry. Our hunger and thirst for justice is your own desire. In the fullness of time, you sent your chosen servant to preach good news to the afflicted, to break bread with the outcast and despised, and to ransom those in bondage to prejudice and sin. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death and resurrection, we await the day when Jesus shall return to free all the earth from the bonds of slavery and death. Come, Lord Jesus, and let the church say amen. 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 Send your Holy Spirit, our advocate, to fill the hearts of all who share this bread and cup with courage and wisdom to pursue love and justice in all the world. Come, Spirit of freedom, and let the church say amen. 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 Join our prayers and praise with your prophets and martyrs of every age, that rejoicing in the hope of the resurrection, we might live in the freedom and hope of your Son. Through him, with him, and the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. At this time, I invite you to take the bread that you have for communion and to eat it. The body of Christ given for you. Amen. And now I invite you to take the wine or the juice that you have prepared and to drink it. The blood of Christ shed for you. Amen. Wellspring of joy, through this meal you have put gladness in our hearts. Satisfy the hunger still around us, and send us as joyful witnesses that your love may bring joy to the hearts of all people. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Throughout this season of Easter, we share in the peace in a new way. We will be doing it not only here in person, but also by Zoom throughout our community. And hopefully we can do this in a way that shares together. In fact, can you guys go ahead and put on the screen up in worship, Samuel and Toby, can you guys put up the shared screen with lots of faces? That would be great. But I'll just go again through the peace in American Sign Language. You simply kind of make an X in front of your heart like this with your hands. Turn them like so, knuckles together, and you. So again, peace with you. Peace with you. And we also have a helpful little diagram in the worship folder. You are welcome to practice that throughout the week. You are welcome to use that throughout the week. If you do that with a stranger, maybe you'd want to even tell them what it is you're doing as you wish them peace. But our community is made up of individual members, and a reminder that we are gathered together as a body. We are the living body of Christ. I invite you to stay in place, but please stand. Share God's peace with one another. The peace of the Lord be with you. Peace be with you. That's still very new to me, but I find it very lovely. It's a very beautiful thing, actually, to see you all share peace in this way. Well, receive God's blessing. May our glorious God grant you a spirit of wisdom to know and to love the risen Lord Jesus, the God of life, creator, liberator, and sustainer. Bless you now and forever. Amen. Amen. A reminder that we do have a 30-minute fellowship time by Zoom immediately following worship. For those in person, you are welcome to head home and get on Zoom and join in that. It's okay to join a little bit late. But again, each and every Sunday morning worship service, we follow that with a 30-minute fellowship time by Zoom.
Go in peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.